Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Kashmir Valley inching towards peace as Indian Army eliminating terrorists in dozens. Pakistan exposed as epicenter of terrorism in latest UNSC report. United States and Pakistan discuss peace process with Afghanistan. And Pakistan court indicts four close aides of Hafiz Saeed in terror financing case. Up on their heels to demolish the cobweb of Pakistan-aided terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir, Indian security forces launched series of counter-terrorism operations this week, neutralizing around 20 terrorists. The Jammu Kashmir police also achieved another success by breaking a significant terror funding network. The police busted a big narco-terrorism module as they recovered large quantity of heroin along with Indian currency and arrested three terrorists associated with Lashkar-e-Taiba who were operating at the commands of Pakistani handlers. A report.
Indian Army Paramilitary Central Reserve Police Force and Jammu and Kashmir Police are jointly carrying out series of operations to uproot the Pakistan-established network of terrorism from the Kashmir Valley. As Kashmir's Shopian district remained the point of action this week, the security forces jointly launched several search operations based on specific inputs about terrorists in various areas of the district. After neutralizing five terrorists in Reban village of Shopian on 7th of June, the security forces laid a cordon in Pinjori village of Shopian district where they neutralized nine terrorists on June 8th in a two-day-long encounter. After neutralizing five terrorists in Reban village of Shopian on 7th of June, the security forces laid a cordon in Pinjori village of Shopian district where they neutralized nine terrorists on June 8th in a two-day-long encounter. Later on 10th June, a gun battle broke out in Sugu area of Shopian as the Indian Army, Paramilitary Central Reserve Police and Jammu and Kashmir Police jointly launched a search operation based on specific inputs about the presence of terrorists in the area. The forces killed another five terrorists on 10th of June in Shopian, taking the total tally of neutralized terrorists to 19 within 4 days. Media reports suggest that over 20 terrorists, including 8 top commanders, have been neutralized in the Kashmir Valley in the last 15 days.
The radical elements, non-state actors, whatever you call them, cross-border terror, criminals, whatever the name is, they are also increasing their activities, but we must appreciate the security forces. They are doing a commendable job. They have written off close to nine of these people in the last 24 hours, and in the last 2 weeks or so, they have over 27 to 30 have been eliminated. This is a very good figure. It's a very good going, and we must admit that their efficiency, their coordination, their intelligence analysis, their intelligence gathering, and their morale, it shows very well that how it is. There is no doubt about it that the elements which are supporting these terrorists across the border, they are getting very demoralized, and they are actually very, very hard put to answer, and they do not know where the answer lies for this. They are actually on the run.
In another breakthrough in an unarmed anti-terrorism action, Jammu and Kashmir police busted a huge narcotics terror module sponsored by Pakistan and arrested three Lashkar-e-Taiba terrorist associates in Hanwada town of Kudwara district. The police also recovered 21 kg heroin and rupees 1.34 crore Indian currency, total worth over rupees 200 crore, from the possession of Lashkar operatives. According to police, the module was in contact with their handlers based out of Pakistan and was involved in drug trade and assisting financially to active terrorists of proscribed terror outfit Lashkar. It was working for LET outfit to strengthen the activities in the valley, besides misguiding and motivating the local youth to join terror folds. The drugs were procured from across the line of control and were to be sold in different states to promote terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir and Punjab.
आज हंदवाड़ा पुलिस ने एक बड़ा पाकिस्तान स्पॉन्सर्ड नार्को टेरर मॉडल को बच किया हमने. इसके साथ तीन लश्कर तोयबा का टेरर एसोसिएट्स को भी गिरफ्तार किया हमने. उसका कब्जे से टोटल 21 केजी हेरोइन जिसकी मार्केट वैल्यू 100 करोड़ के बराबर है और 1.34 करोड़ का इंडियन करेंसी बरामद की.
The high-handedness of Indian security forces over Pakistan's vicious network of terrorism and the country's depleting economy has left the country bewildered. As its trained terrorists are only seeing the face of defeat and death, the money being pushed into the terror network is adversely charging the country. Use of narcotics for terror funding by Pakistan's ISI is being seen as a trick to avoid being traced back. But to its much disappointment and humiliation, even the narco terror network of Islamabad stands exposed now as the Indian security forces have upped their arms against Pakistan-sponsored terrorism at all fronts.
Since Pakistan is becoming broke, they are paying all their handler, their agents over here in India through heroin and other hard drugs. That way, they are ensuring that they are not traced back, the amount is not traced back to them, because after NIA started going after the money trail and arrested a lot of hawala handlers and a lot of traders also who were complicit with Pakistan ISI and Pakistan government in channeling the and funneling the money from Pakistan to the agents over here and the militants in Kashmir, they have now decided to use hard drugs as a source of payments, and this arrest of these three people is a proof to that.
At a time when the countries are making an integrated approach to face the challenge of COVID-19 pandemic, Pakistan is focusing on its strategies to spread terrorism in its neighbor and across the globe. Pakistani army generals, who are the real masterminds behind most of the terror attacks, believe that the world won't notice their devious plans amid the pandemic outbreak. But to their surprise, not only all the diabolic activities are being monitored, but are being given a befitting reply by the Indian forces.
Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed, the terror group sponsored and supported by Pakistan, have been expanding their wings in Afghanistan under a well-planned strategy by Islamabad to fuel terrorism in Kabul. Reflecting upon an assessment by UN Security Council that Pakistani terrorists formed a significant part of the foreign fighters that pose a serious threat to Afghanistan's security, India asserted that the report vindicated India's long-standing that Pakistan remained the epicenter of international terrorism. We have a report.
Pakistan not only shelters dreaded terrorists in its own territory, but provides constant support to Taliban and other terrorist groups in neighboring Afghanistan. A report by the Analytical Support and Sanctions Monitoring Team submitted to the UN Security Council recently reveals that Pakistani terror organizations such as the Lashkar-e-Taiba, the Jaish-e-Mohammed and Tehrik-e-Taliban Pakistan send their trainers to Afghanistan to carry out assassinations. According to the report, there are some 6,500 Pakistani nationals among foreign terrorists operating in Afghanistan, and the Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Taiba play a key role in bringing foreign fighters into the war-torn country. Such reports complement Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan's statement that there are 30,000 to 40,000 terrorists operating in the country. The sole aim of these terrorists is to unleash chaos and violence in India and Afghanistan at the commands of ISI.
UN Security Council has come out with a report in the category state that Pakistan is the cause of all chaos, mayhem and turmoil in Afghanistan as well in South Asia. And they said this Pakistan itself has accepted this. Imran Khan has gone on record to say that there are 30 to 40,000 terrorists that operate in Pakistan and they've been using Pakistani soil for nefarious activities. However, Pakistan is challenging the report of the, questioning the report and findings of the UN Security Council, not realizing that it has already emerged as a global epicenter of terrorism and the entire world is already aware of it.
Pakistan-based terror groups are engaged in trafficking terrorists or fighters of the Taliban, Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State into Afghanistan, who are threatening to derail the peace process in the war-torn country. Days after the UNSC's report spotlighted the induction of over 6,000 foreign fighters into Afghanistan, a separate report revealed that Pakistan's ISI is infiltrating the Lashkar and Jaish terrorists into the Islamic State Khorasan province that has been in tatters after the arrest of its chief Abdullah Orakzai or Aslam Farooqi and his top commanders by Afghan security forces. ISI officials have created the financial and logistics support network to facilitate their operations in ISKP. The relocated Lashkar groups have organized attacks in Afghan cities and ambushed border security posts of the Afghan National Defense and security forces in coordination with the Taliban, its sword arm, the Haqqani Network and Al-Qaeda. Pakistan has failed in fulfilling its international obligations to put an end to supporting terrorism as its state machineries like the ISI and the army continue to aid terror activities in South Asian region.
Pakistan, I think, very seriously needs to introspect on its foreign policy, especially on the policy which it has undertaken to use terrorism as an instrument of its foreign policy. And unless Pakistan reverses course, I think we are unlikely to see any change in Pakistani actions. And the biggest sufferers here, while India will be able to handle the impact, I think the biggest sufferers are going to be the people of Pakistan, because terrorism has already consumed the state, but I think it will destroy the state completely.
Acknowledging UNSC's report and expressing grave concern over Pakistan's role in supporting terrorism, Indian Ministry of External Affairs said that we note with serious concern presence of senior leadership of UN-designated terrorist organizations, Al-Qaeda and its affiliates in Afghanistan, as well as a large number of foreign terrorist fighters, including up to 6,500 Pakistani nationals operating in Afghanistan. This vindicates India's long-standing position that PAK remains an epicenter of international terrorism, that proscribed terrorist entities and individuals continue to enjoy safe havens and recruit, train, arm, finance and operate with impunity from Pakistan with state support. Pakistan's deep state has never realized that supporting terror groups can never settle disputes, especially as far as India and Afghanistan are concerned. Instead of restricting the spread of terrorism in the region, Pakistan has only put up a sorry face when inquired by international community about its action plan on controlling terrorism. Its failure in curbing terror activities and terror financing has landed it thrice in the grey list of FATF.
Hopes for peace in Afghanistan appear to be slipping away as the Taliban stepped up attacks against Afghan security forces after the end of a brief ceasefire on the occasion of Eid al-Fitr in May. However, the United States is making continuous efforts to help restart the stalled intra-Afghan peace talks. Recently, U.S. Special Envoy for Afghanistan Zalmay Khalilzad met Afghan President Ashraf Ghani and discussed the commencement of Afghan peace process this week. Our report.
Mm-hmm.
Ahead of the crucial intra-Afghan negotiations, U.S. Special Envoy for Afghanistan Zalmay Khalilzad held talks with Afghan President Ashraf Ghani in Kabul on the commencement of Afghanistan's peace process this week. According to President Ghani's spokesperson, Khalilzad and President Ghani discussed the required practical steps ahead of the start of the intra-Afghan negotiations, the terms for the extension of a reduction in violence, the unofficial ceasefire, and the commitments to the Afghan peace process by the international community and neighboring countries. This recent visit came a day after Pakistan's Army Chief of Staff General Qamar Javed Bajwa, who visited Kabul this week, held talks with President Ashraf Ghani and Abdullah Abdullah, head of the High Council for National Reconciliation, and discussed start of peace efforts and Pakistan's role in the process. They also discussed that how the soil of either country should not be used against the other. However, in order to move from conflict to peace, a clear and well-defined relations between Pakistan and the Taliban has to be formalized in the Afghan peace agreement, as the countries are marred by deep mistrust due to Pakistan's long-standing ties with the Taliban.
The present government in Afghanistan does not trust Pakistan. In fact, it considers Pakistan as part of the problem. Taliban is being financed and equipped by ISI. It gets political support from Pakistan. Pakistan wants Taliban to rule Afghanistan so that Pakistan can have its own say and regain the strategic depth which it has been looking for in Afghanistan.
Disagreement over the Taliban's demand for the release of 5,000 prisoners has also blocked progress towards resolving the conflict, in which Pakistan is considered a key regional player. But now, the Afghan government plans to complete a Taliban prisoner release to pave the way for peace talks with the militant group. President Ghani told in an interview that 3,000 Taliban prisoners have already been released and additional 2,000 prisoners will be freed within a short period as part of the US-Taliban peace deal. Taliban political spokesman Suhail Shaheen tweeted that the prisoner release by the Afghan government so far was a positive step and marked good progress. Zalmay Khalilzad, who negotiated and signed the deal with the Taliban, hailed the progress in the prisoner swap. In a series of tweets, Khalilzad also welcomed the Taliban's announcement that they were ready to enter into peace talks, saying it was a commitment outlined in the agreement.
I don't think peace will return so easily to Afghanistan. Pakistan wants Afghanistan to be in turmoil. If at all it wants the present Afghan government to be replaced by the Taliban. That will take time. Therefore, to ensure that the talks between Taliban and America do not fail, Pakistan has moved in Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Taiba into Afghanistan. It is now planned to use these two terrorist groups instead of Taliban. Pakistan ISI has also teamed up with other splinter groups operating in Afghanistan, like the Islamic State in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, Islamic State in Khorasan province, and certain offshoots of Al-Qaeda.
Peace looks still an elusive dream in the war-torn nation, as the scale of violence has significantly increased in past few weeks. According to the Afghan government, the Taliban has carried out an average of 30 attacks on the Afghan security forces each day after the Eid al-Fitr ceasefire. Consequently, American forces conducted two airstrikes on Taliban fighters to foil the militant group's plan to launch attacks on Afghan security forces in a move that could hurt the peace process. The US and the Taliban signed a deal in February that paves the way for American and foreign forces to leave Afghanistan. However, both Kabul and Washington are unsure and uncomfortable over the question whether peace will definitely return to the war-torn country once the US Army departs.
chances of peace returning to Afghanistan are very bleak at present. Pakistan, which is a major player in the area, is not at all interested in bringing peace to Afghanistan. It wants the state of flux to continue, though it's interested in America to leave so that thereafter it can help Taliban to secure the seat in Kabul through force. And it knows that the Afghan forces will not be able to support or will not be able to fight Pakistan-supported Taliban. That is why it's just vying for time and waiting for America to leave. But situation in Afghanistan will continue to be in turmoil till such time Taliban get firmly in seat in Afghanistan, which Pakistan desires.
The continuous surge of violence by Taliban is suggestive of an unchanged stance and strategy the Taliban despite all the talks. And this escalation in confrontation between security forces and the Taliban means a further deterioration in the security situation of the country, divisions and damages to the peace process, and the dream of return of peace that has remained elusive becoming unachievable.
Under immense international pressure, Pakistan Anti-Terrorism Court indicted four close aides of Hafiz Saeed on terror financing charges this week. The move seems nothing but just an exercise to hoodwink the international community in order to avoid the wrath of FATF and escape the economic sanctions from various foreign financing institutions and countries allied with Pakistan. Our report.
Pakistan for decades has been sponsoring and aiding terror organizations on its soil, which are responsible for a large number of terrorist attacks in the entire world, especially India. However, with the huge pressure from the international community building up, Pakistan has been compelled to take actions against these terrorists. In the recent development, an anti-terrorism court in Pakistan indicted four top leaders of the banned Jamaat-ud-Dawah and close aides of the 2008 Mumbai terror attack mastermind Hafiz Saeed in a terror financing case. All four accused, however, pleaded not guilty and chose to contest the trial. The move comes after global pressure on the country to bring terror leaders residing in the country to justice.
Much as I would like to believe that this is genuine action, you have to look at everything in the overall context of things. And knowing what is happening otherwise in Pakistan on the terrorist activities, I would tend to believe that this is just an eyewash. There is, Pakistan got a lot of pressure from the international community now that they must take action, right? So over a period of time now, they keep doing this every now and then. Some action is taken. Okay. So it is because of the international pressure.
The counter-terrorism department of Pakistan had registered 23 FIRs against 70-year-old Saeed and his accomplices on the charges of terror financing. Under pressure from the international community, the Pakistani authorities also launched investigations into matters of the Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jamaat-ud-Dawah and its charity wing Falah-e-Insaniyat Foundation for their holding and use of trusts to raise funds for terrorism financing. At least 56 seminaries and facilities being run by the JUD and FIF in southern Sindh province were also taken over by authorities in the same case. Consequently, Hafiz Saeed, the co-founder and chief of these terrorist groups, was arrested in connection with charges relating to terror financing and has been detained at Kot Lakhpat Jail. Later, he was sentenced to 11 years in jail in terror financing cases just a few days ahead of FATF meeting in February, which retained Pakistan in its grey list. The controversial point, however, is whether these actions against Saeed and his accomplices are indicative of a new direction in Pakistan's counter-terrorism policy or merely a tactical ploy, as before, to escape economic sanctions and avoid the wrath of international community.
It is not in the interest of the Pakistani military establishment to have peace on the borders and find a solution to our problems. Why? Because they will then lose their importance. Now, that being the case, they have these terror outfits and they use the terror outfits to create the problems on the borders, terror financing, terrorists coming in, everything of the kind, because it suits the Pakistani establishment.
In spite of these so-called measures by Pakistan's counter-terrorism department, there seems to be absolutely no curb being put on terror financing and terror activities taking place in the country. Global terror financing watchdog has warned Pakistan to do more to rein in terrorist groups operating from its soil or face the consequences. If Pakistan fails to comply with FATF this time, it will face a much more aggressive and friendless international community where it is possible that even allies like China no longer help to bail out Pakistan in future.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Yeshi Chonsom signing off on the behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.